Hello, friend. I have a story to tell you today. It's the story of my daughter's life. She died of lung cancer at the age of 39. And I have written a book which I think is helpful to us today in the very difficult circumstances in which we live. It brings hope and encouragement and a sense that all is well. I hope you enjoy it.
I've never been happy, Shirley keeps saying in 2012. And now? I ask timidly. Now? Now I'm just 5 years unhappier. She talks about chucking the IT industry. She hates it and thinks she's too gentle for it. It certainly is every man for himself and they take no prisoners. Or should she move to London? Study again? Perhaps a radical change is what she needs. Should she pack it all in and come back to South Africa? This is dangerous. Will sweeping away nearly all the support she now has, besides mine, be a good thing? She's made so many bad choices. Her words. Will this be another huge one? She's very discerning and she asks, if I do all this and get into a job which is more suited to my gifting, will I perhaps find that actually I don't feel any better? Sweetheart, what if the problem is inside you, I ask, heart in my mouth. Then wherever you go, you'll simply be taking it with you. I write to Chris, whom I hardly know at this stage. The last 2 weekends, Shirley's just cried and cried and cried over the phone. So harrowing, believe me. She keeps saying that she can't cope anymore. She and I both are cling-wrapped in fear. What if she calls me on the point of suicide? What do I do then? Who can get to her really fast? I plead for phone numbers. Chris puts me in touch with one of the pastors for a start. She writes, your dear daughter needs much prayer, and I know that folk at the church have a heart for her and are praying for her. Nick replies, Thigh, I understand a bit of what this is like for you. I'm a father of three myself. But Shirley is loved, prayed for, and protected by a number of wonderful people. If I genuinely feared for her safety, I would with others such as Chris be in touch. I trust that God won't let such a thing happen. I'm comforted, but only to a point. I don't think I've managed to get them to realize how serious this really is. These days, I'm on the alert for anything or anyone that will tell me more of what's going on. That she can't sleep or get up in the mornings is some indication of how bad her depression is. Unfortunately, none of us realizes the full significance of such severe insomnia and angst. Often the sadness in Shirley's voice makes me take down the bedroom phone and sink onto the floor. In winter, I pull the heated towels off the rail and wrap them around me. Time after time, I put the phone down, feeling wrung dry. Nothing keeps out this cold. What else can I do but soothe, encourage, and envelop her in love? I hear you and bleed inside with you. This unhappiness thing is why you are so terribly tired, so unbearably tired. And encourage. I admire you because you're made of great stuff. And I love you, Shirley. Every time Shirley suggests there is no hope, I just unravel. I don't know when the next blow will fall, but I do know it will. How come she needs to even ask such a question, I agonize. When she does ask it again and again, grim foreboding, it's fear, wrenches at my gut. Does she want me to agree? Because then she'll feel justified to do whatever. I hear decision in her voice when she says one last time, there really isn't any hope, is there? What's the point? What's the point of going on? This is beyond terrible. Oh, how much I want to hold her to make it better. But she's in her late 30s now. And what's more, I am always, it seems, 6,000 unforgiving miles away. Often in the dark hours of the night, Shirley prays fervently that God please, please take her. I'm so disappointed when I'm still here the next morning, she moans. In her copy of Larry Crabb's book, The Pressure's Off, she underlines the following. Occasionally, an event gathers into it all the pain and terror of existence, and our souls are undone. Agony rolls down into our deepest heart, crowding out any experience of gladness and hope. And all we can do is wail. As 2013 begins, I realize things are ominously worse. Now Shirley is quite irrational at times. James 1:18a says, He chose to give us birth through the word of truth. But if Shirley has become so mentally unstable that she can no longer rationally respond to truth, what's left? Mum, you're the only one who's always there for me, she says. This loads me with more responsibility at a time when I'm increasingly aware that I'm fast running out of ideas. Over the years, I've kept encouraging her to make her own choices, at last taking control of her life. Now she herself says, I can't do this anymore. I need someone to take care of me. It cannot get more serious. My brilliant, beautiful daughter is actually psychotic, mentally ill. It means the lifeline I try to hold out to her has just gone limp. I confide in my doctor. He says that from what he can tell, Shirley's very depressed. This is probably caused by a deep-seated psychological problem. This is my cue. Now I simply have to muscle in. My beyond frantic need is to rescue my child. Even though it seems hopeless, I simply can't do nothing. A long time ago, I reluctantly made peace with the idea that Shirley should be permanently on pills. It was horribly hard to accept. But I came to understand that life for her was plain awful without it, not really doable. I'm desperate enough to play with fire, so I bring up the subject of antidepressants. Shirley puts me in my place. Last time I went to the doctor about depression, he was very, very reluctant to give me pills. He said he would, but because the last time was only 6 months ago, if I need to come back again, he would have to do a psychiatric assessment. So I can't go back, Mum. I'll get it on my medical record. No, I'm going to do it through counselling with Phyllis. You need to know, we've discussed it already. All I can see is a history of depression and black holes. For a start, there have been 3 or 4 episodes since her divorce. Counselling alone has never worked before, so why should it now? I try many times to persuade Shirley and she needs pills as well. I know that to do this is to risk any relationship I have with her, really fragile at best nowadays. Is it worth risking a complete breakdown between us? In the end, I decide the crisis is so extreme, I have no other choice. I love her far too much not to even try. My heart in my mouth, I email, Sweetheart, you've tried to do without pills before, but it hasn't worked, has it? Silence. Days go by. So I write again. This thing's pretty pervasive, isn't it? It's destroying your happiness. It's making you more and more desperate. It seems the problem has always been there, but it can be dealt with. I'm sure of it. You can be freed up. I know, I really know what I'm asking is huge. It involves overcoming massive fear. She's already terrified, and I'm asking her to add to it. God help me, I have to do this, because I believe this is the only chance she has. To try to make it easier for her, I make light of it and treat the whole alarming issue as a normal, ordinary, day-to-day matter. This has only the remotest chance of working, so, perhaps unforgivably, I resort to coercion. The ends seem, to me at any rate, in such an extreme case, to justify the means. I'm not doing any of this without praying, but I do what is my own plan. So much for faith. You can come out into the sunshine and play among the daisies, you know. I write that to make it seem easy. Silly? Absurd? totally insensitive? More silence. Sadly, I try once again. I hear your anguish when you say no guy'll look at you because he knows you're on pills. You tell me Dylan actually said that. Then the same Dylan comments on how miserable you've been without pills. I know you're always a delight on mild medication. If you've been on something, Dylan would never have needed to make a comment like that in the first place. Silence. You have all it takes because you're so attractive, physically and otherwise. She doesn't reply. Her silence shows how insensitive she's finding me. I go on trying to lower the hurdle as much as possible. A psychiatric assessment's not necessarily a bad thing. Knowing exactly what the situation is will put you in a position to deal with it. If there is a problem, it's possible to do the right thing about it and free you up once and for all. If, on the other hand, they say there's no problem, how cool to have it confirmed. Then you don't have to wonder ever again. I wait and wait, but her silence remains unbroken. I write once again. Use that very pretty head of yours. You stand at the crossroads of making the very decisions that can change your future experience of life radically. Are you going to put this problem in its place? Or are you going to allow it to continue to wreak havoc in your life? This time Shirley responds with a phone call. Mum, stop trying to put me in a box. You think I'm mental. You're always trying to diagnose and label me. How do you think I feel when my own mother's doing this? My ears sting from the boxing. I knew that the risk was enormous, but I'm still incredibly sad that it has turned out like this. And then, out of the blue, a little email arrives. Hey, Mum, I just wanted to say that I love you so much. Differences of opinion aside, it's precious and means we're still talking. Perhaps only just. How very relieved I am. There is quite an increase in the emotional distance between us, but I'm left hoping that in time things can be mended. Nat, a close friend, reminds me of Galatians 4:19, where Paul speaks of birthing Christ in us. That's your role, Ma, she hugs me. You birthing Shirley all over again. Really? Well, what could be more important than that? I've been reading from my book, Mum, Please Help Me Die, the story of my daughter Shirley's battle with cancer. If you'd like to get a copy of the book, please contact me. You can do that at the following email address, thi@mumpleasehelpmedie.co.za. I hope you'll be with me again next week. Goodbye.